Hi, I'm Gabe Maguire, and you're watching Soundstage Country. Some of you may or may not know me from my 35 years on the road, during which time I've had the pleasure of working with many of the greats in the Irish music industry. In this series, I'm going to catch up with some of my old friends, starting tonight with the Louisiana man, Robert Mizzell.
Gabe, good evening.
I actually had the pleasure of working with Rob for a number of years. Delighted to have you along.
Well, it's great to see you in this new guise. I remember Gabe years ago when we worked together. I used to always say, where's Gabe? He's out of the truck bringing in gear and setting up things. This is a whole new thing for you.
It's a whole new thing.
Yeah.
But first of all, let me take you back to the early days and a young Robert Mizzell in Louisiana. What was life like there?
Well, I suppose, I'm thinking about Louisiana a lot more in the last couple of months with the lockdown and thinking about family. I was only talking to my father today, actually. Louisiana for me in those early days was a difficult time. My mother and father had some issues. But I remember one thing that always stands out about Louisiana that we don't see too much of in Ireland at the minute, the heat. Yeah. I mean, it was hot. I mean, it was so hot down there. And I grew up around a lake, and not too far from where we lived, we'd come home from school of an afternoon, and we would do our homework, and my mother would say, right, off you go. So we'd cross the road, head down about a quarter mile down to the lake, jump in, bring a bar of soap with you. You might have your bath down there, and you could fish down there, you could eat down there and sleep down there. So it was like home. It was, but I suppose, you know, all of those years of childhood growing up in Louisiana, it was sort of preparing me for where I've come to now.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about that more later on.
And you spoke of your parents there, and I've read that you actually credit them as your influences and them singing in local churches, whatever. Do you remember those times, and did you join them as a child?
Well, believe it or not, my mother and father never knew I sang properly until I think I came to Ireland. I do remember, we all have these sort of unusual stories, but many, many years ago, in a place called Carthage, Texas, which is not too far from Shreveport, my mother and father were involved in a gospel band. And the way it used to work in those days, on a Sunday, they would do an afternoon show, a service, and then another evening show in the service. And we were down just hanging out after the morning service was over. Of course, Louisiana, the weather was nice and hot down near Texas as well. And we were running around playing with bugs outside and, you know, finding puddles or whatever we could do to amuse ourselves. And my aunt drove down from Shreveport to tell us that my granddad had passed away. So I'll never forget Carthage, Texas for that. But I also remember my mother and father, I used to watch these people sing. My dad's a great singer, and anybody who's been following my career over the last number of years would know that he's visited here and he's sang with me. But a lot of people don't know that my mother was probably a better singer than all of us. And I'm happy to say that, but I'm also sad because I think that had she gotten the opportunities that I've had, that she might have done something with her career, because she was an amazing woman for singing. I remember when we were kids, you know, she'd go around the house singing, and she could rattle the windows in the house. She had such a voice. And I sort of lend it Tanya Tucker, a Patsy Cline, that sort of a singer, but she also delved in blues and jazz. So they were a great influence on me, but they didn't even know us.
Okay, and aside from the tones of your mother's voice, were there any other music happening in the house? What were you listening to?
Well, believe it or not, from what I can remember growing up as a young boy, I used to listen to Michael Jackson and Stevie Wonder and Peter Cetera and Journey. That's all the stuff that I was into, maybe because I was just a young teenager. But I think when I got to Ireland, and I know I'm skipping ahead a little bit, but when I got to Ireland then, I suddenly realized how popular country music was here. I didn't realize it. And then automatically, I found my country voice. Because I have a natural low voice, I didn't have the same type of voice that Steve Perry had. So yeah. I think country music was the obvious choice for me.
Yeah. And later in your life, we'll come back to that possibly, but you spoke about Mama Courtney, your foster mama, and did she have any influence on your music, and did she encourage you to sing? Or?
Well, Mama Courtney probably didn't know. I mean, I was very young when I first went to Mama Courtney. I mean, the first time I met Mama Courtney, the first time we were introduced, I was only 6 months old, so I don't remember much of that time. But I do remember many years later, she told me that she had, one of her eldest girls, Peggy, had got a recording of me standing out on the porch singing as if I had an audience in front of me, and she taped it. Now, I've never heard the recording, but so somewhere in my existence, in my psyche, maybe I knew then that I was going to be an entertainer, but I didn't know at that stage myself. I didn't know. And sadly enough, Mama Courtney passed away long before I got a chance to really take off in the music industry. So that's one of my regrets, that she didn't get a chance to see me. But of course, she's watching.
Okay. Then we'll take you forward to the age of 17, and you moved upstate to Connecticut to work with your father in the painting and decorating business. Mm. New state, new experiences. How was that life for you?
Well, moving to Connecticut from Louisiana is like moving from Tipperary to Belfast. Okay. You know, it's in the same country, but the people were completely different. And but, you know, when you look at the geographical setup of where Connecticut is, Louisiana, Connecticut, and then to Ireland, I was always moving east. But I found that experience meeting different people, because if I hadn't been involved in the music industry and hadn't moved to Connecticut, I would probably still be in Louisiana. And I think my horizons wouldn't have been broadened. So I enjoyed that time. I used to work in a marina down there in New Haven, near New Haven, Connecticut, and a beautiful part of the world. But so much different than Louisiana.
And you found it easy to mix and mingle with new people and get along with them?
Yeah, generally. I think, you know, down in Connecticut, if a Southern boy like me went in with a pair of cowboy boots on you, they sort of didn't understand it, because, you know, they weren't used to seeing that sort of thing. I've always got on, and I still have friends there, and I haven't been back to Connecticut. I've been to New York a few times, but I haven't been back there in many years. But it's a place that has some fond memories for me.
On reflection, would you call that a good chapter in your life? Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I think so. I mean, when I was in Connecticut, I joined the military at that time, and I was dating my eldest girl's mother. She's from Kildare, and it was a difficult time in the sense that we were just about to get deployed to the Persian Gulf during the first Gulf War. I went into the military I wanted to be a police officer. And the quickest route for that, for me, was going through the military. I became a military police officer. And then I thought then I'd maybe go back to the South or go to New York and become a police officer. But of course, through all of that, Ireland got in the way. But thankfully it did.
And how old were you at that time, and how big a decision was it to go join the army?
I was 18 when I joined the army, and I think it was a very easy decision for me, because I think at that age, like most 18-year-old young fellas, I didn't have a trade, I didn't have a job, my father was off doing his thing, my mother was in Louisiana, and I sort of needed something that was going to pull me back on track, because I think a lot of young fellas nowadays they look for somewhere to attach themselves. Mm. And my family was sort of dispersed around the country. So the army was basically, it was my family. And I really enjoyed it. And I swear to God, out of all the things I've done in my life, going into the military at 18 was one of the best things I ever done.
Good decision.
Good decision.
Well, that seems like a good time in the conversation to take a little break. And we're going to ask Rob to make his way to the main stage to do what he does best, performing the George Jones classic, He Stopped Loving Her Today, Robert Mizzell.
He said, I love you till I die. She told him, you were getting tired. And as the years went slowly by, she still preyed upon his mind. He kept her picture always warm. He went half crazy now and then, but he still loved her through it all. I hope when she come back again, kept some letters by his bed. Did in 1962, and he had underlining it, every single I love. I went to see him just today. Oh, but I didn't see no tears. all dressed up to go away. First time I seen him smiling, why he stopped loving her today. Ain't plans to read the pound on his door, and soon they'll carry him away. He stopped loving her today.
You know, she came to see him just one last time. Oh, and we all wondered if she would. But it keeps running through my mind. This time, he's over her for good.
Why, he stopped loving her today. They placed a wreath upon his door, and soon they'll carry him away. He stopped loving her today.
That was great from Rob, and while he makes his way back to join us here, we'd ask you to hit like, subscribe, and share with your friends to let them know that we're here every Monday night at 9 p.m. So, Rob, you've just left the army and you're now in your early 20s, and you decide to move to Ireland. Why Ireland?
Well, I was going out. Myself and Amy's mother had just got together, and we'd met in Connecticut, and I was sort of with all of the past history that I had in Louisiana. I didn't really want to be there at the time. You know, myself and my family, we weren't that close at that point in my life. And I said, you know what? Why not? I want to go and see the world. I want to get out of here. I want to see something. So I made a big decision. I quit the army. I didn't say I quit. I signed myself out pretty much. I went on indefinite leave. I moved to Ireland, and myself and Elaine were to be married the following. I arrived on the 26th of December, and we were getting married on the 4th of January. So I was only here for 5 days or something, and we got married. But I always tell people, I knew her before that. I don't work that fast.
And did you know much about Ireland prior to coming here? And has anything changed, or what's your view of us now?
Well, I can tell you, Gaby, if somebody, and this is the honest truth, if somebody had taken out a map and opened it up and said, Robert, show me where Ireland is, I had no idea. I mean, being from Louisiana, coming up as a young boy, I mean, Ireland just wasn't in our vocabulary. I didn't know where it was.
Okay.
So, yeah, when you say, has it changed a lot? Yes, Ireland has changed a ferocious amount. Mm. And, bearing in mind, I'm here 30 years. A lot of it very good. It took me a long time to get used to the climate. As we know, it can rain here a little bit. Every now and again. But I find that the Irish people are very much like the people of Louisiana.
Yeah.
I mean, if you meet an Irish man or a woman anywhere in the country, you can spark up a conversation. And sure, I know how to talk, so I'm happy with that.
Yeah.
And I find that the majority of Irish people, you could just lift them out of Ireland and put them in Louisiana, and they'd love it. And of course, they'd love the weather as well.
Well, some people might claim, actually, you went on Google and tried to find a place that rained more than Louisiana.
Well, in Louisiana, if you woke up on a Friday and the sun was shining, you could almost guarantee it for a month.
Okay.
In Ireland, it's not quite that good.
A little less.
But there's no dust here. There's no dust.
You're happy with that?
Happy with that, yeah.
And tell us about your early days in Ireland and your first jobs and your steps of moving into the music industry.
Oh. Well, you see, there again, I told this story in another interview a couple of months ago. The music business happened to me rather than me looking for it.
Okay.
Because at that time, when I first got to Ireland, I was working on building sites. And at one stage, I worked for a representative. I sold mops and buckets. I sold microwave ovens. And I still hadn't figured out what I was going to do.
Okay.
I had left my army career behind. I had left my law enforcement career behind. And I had met a friend of mine from Kildare. He's one of the head pilots in Aer Lingus, and he went on to do other things. But he was involved in a musical society in Kildare. And one day, just by chance, we got talking. And we were in his car, and I never forget, if you remember the old days of the portable CD players that you plugged into the into the car, they weren't actually installed. And we were driving down the road, and this CD was skipping because of the bumps in the car. But he was playing a Garth Brooks album.
Okay.
So I started singing along. And Henry, the guy's name, he said, Robert, he says, you're a great singer. I said, yeah, of course I am, yeah. And he said, no, I think you should look into this, you know. And I said, really? I says, so that moment was sort of the first moment that I discovered that, okay, maybe I can do this. Now, there's a lot that happened in the meantime or since then that brought me to where I am today.
Yeah.
But had it not been for that conversation in that car that day, I could have still be selling mops and buckets.
And did you go to the musical society with him, or did you start?
No, I didn't. No, I never did. No, he moved on. His wife was from Germany. He moved on. I myself and Lane were raising a little baby because my eldest girl now is 26 and she just got engaged, by the way, recently.
Oh,
so,
yeah, excellent.
So I'm delighted. I'm delighted for that. But no, at that stage, but it seemed like once I got the notion that I might be able to do this, all of a sudden, let's do this. So I started pushing myself, and I remember the first gig I ever done in Ireland was in Tommy Toker's bar in Newbridge in County Kildare. Yep. Elaine's father had bought two Carlsbro speakers and a 50 or 150 watt amp. We plugged the two speakers in. I had a guy with me who I met who played a bit of guitar because I couldn't play guitar at the time. And we sat there and we sang. And about after the show was over, there's about 10 people watching. And after the gig was over, this guy comes up to me and he says, "Hi, I'm Jimmy Smith." He says, "And I'd like to offer you a recording contract."
Okay.
And I sort of course, bearing in mind, I'm still from Louisiana. I still had the heat in me. I hadn't even cooled down yet. And I went home and I said to Elaine, I said, "Elaine, you're not going to believe this." I said, "I've done one show." And this guy offered me a recording contract. Now, as we know, in the world of music, that can mean lots of things.
Yeah.
Now, it didn't work out between me and Jimmy, and things didn't go the way I thought they were going to go. But there was another door that opened up in the music business.
Yeah.
And
that you didn't go looking for.
I didn't go looking for it. You know, sort of expanding on from that, an acquaintance of yours that you'll know very well, Willie Carty, came into my life, and just before him, Tommy Swarbrick was involved with me, and then I started working with Willie, and that was probably the first time that I had a manager who was able to open up the doors to major venues and major places around Ireland so that I could be heard.
Yeah.
And me and Willie worked together for, I must have been 7 or 8 years.
Well, to date, you've released 12 albums and 2 DVDs with your band, The Country Kings. Mm. Tell me about the early days of touring and gigging in Ireland and your impressions of all that.
Well, it was interesting. We used to have an old 709, a Mercedes 709 van, and I've never been a great mechanic, but in those early days, I learned how to change the oil and keep the oil from spilling out and, fix petrol leaks and hose pipes and stuff. But, you know, in those days, Ireland was a completely different place to what it is now. I mean, it's completely different. And I think I probably drank all my earnings in those early days. We used to drive to a venue, we'd do the gig, and we could stay up all night drinking. The next day, we'd dust off the cobwebs, back into the van, and go here.
Yeah.
So at the end of most weeks, I had a ball, and then I used to ask myself, how am I going to pay for the van? Because I had no money left. But, you know, I suppose those were, as I call it, the days of the bandits. And we just, I mean, I've been to every county. I've probably traveled through every town in Ireland at least once.
Yeah.
And I have some fond memories of some of those places. And I was glad to leave some of them behind and fond memories of other ones.
And initially then, a genuine American country singer arriving in the Irish dance scene, how did they take to you?
Well, look, I can honestly say that, you know, had it not been for people of the people of Ireland's generosity and their opening their arms to my music, it couldn't have worked. Now, it must have been weird for them. Because, you know, there's all these other country singers who've been in Ireland for years, going back to the days of Big Tom. And in comes this guy. Now, a lot of people at that time used to come up to me, "Yeah, you're American. Yeah, good man. Fair play to you. Great accent. Like that." I'm like, "No, I'm American." "Yeah, Good man, fair play to you. So that happened for a long time. And then after a while, I think when people realized I was American, you know, he is American. You can't sing though. You know, I mean, I get all sorts of, but that's what I like about Irish people.
Yeah.
You know, a guy who comes up and tells you you're completely crap, he actually likes you.
Yeah. And that's an indirect compliment.
There's lots of other things he could have said.
Well, obviously the scene has changed over the years. Have you seen obviously a number of changes and watched how it's evolved?
Yeah, I mean, back in the 90s and back in the early noughties, I mean, people were out dancing 5-6 nights a week. Obviously, things have changed, and for the better, I must add, the drinking driving laws tightened up, the smoking ban came in, and those were the first couple of cracks that appeared in my industry, because we started thinking to ourselves, well, you know, people aren't going to be coming out as much because they can't take a drink because they have to worry about driving the next morning. And then if you like a smoke, you can't have a smoke here. You have to go outside. And believe it or not, that did sort of tear away at our industry a little bit. Mm. But we were still lucky enough that we had a legion of loyal country music fans. Mm. And the business has changed. And then, of course, if we smack into and see what's happening now with the coronavirus, I mean, the next time we do an interview, you can ask me how it all turned out. And I hope I have a good, positive story for you.
I hope we're all here to tell that story. And the song that actually made you arguably a household name in Ireland and the UK was Say You Love Me. How did that song come about? Did you have any affection or affiliation with it?
Well, no, it's a song that I could not stand it when I heard it.
Really?
I didn't like it. And not because of the song, but I'll tell you the story. Going back to Willie Carty. Willie Carty arrived in, we were recording down in Headford, and Willie Carty arrived in with a recording of the song by Desi O'Halloran.
Oh,
you know, and now I'm an American from Louisiana, and Desi is a well-respected Chanos singer, which I couldn't even say that word 20 years ago, and he came in, and Willie said to me, "This song is going to be a hit," and I'm like, "Really?" I said, "Are you serious?" I said, "Willie, no way. I mean, you're pulling my leg here." He said, "No, you listen to it now." So Frankie Coulihan was the producer on that track. And I was in the recording booth and I had the earphones on and I was going complete crazy. I was like, "Man, I can't sing. I ain't singing this. It's terrible." And Frankie came in, "Huh, man, sing it, sing it." So I sang it. And then when I heard it back, you know, I said, that's just a catchy song. So the song was probably the biggest individual hit that I've ever had. And I always tell the story and the reason I know this, because that song on my very first album is track number 7. And you can flick through the album and you can play all the first song is Hello Mr. DJ and then it goes on down. But when that song comes on, you know why it's a hit.
Floor filler.
It's a floor filler. And you know, if anybody could write that formula and say that's a hit because, then we'd all be multimillionaires. Yeah. But nobody knows. But as I say, and over the last 20 odd years of me being in the business, I've never done a gig yet, a live gig, that I haven't sang it.
Well, we mentioned Mama Courtney just a little earlier there, and in 2010, the great Henry McMahon wrote Mama Courtney, a great hit for you.
Yeah.
How did it feel to relate your childhood story through a number one single?
Yeah, well, I knew Henry had written songs for Michael English. He had written songs for Daniel and Jimmy Buckley and all these other singers, and of course, Big Tom. And I was talking to Henry. Henry was on one of my trips in Spain. Or no, I was on Jimmy Buckley's trip, actually, and Henry was there. And we were having a coffee one day, and Henry sort of just asked me about my life. You know, I don't think he knew as much about me then. So I started telling him the story of Mama Courtney. I started telling him the story about how I lived and the fact that Papa Courtney drove a pickup truck and Mama Courtney fostered all these different children. And he rang me the next morning up to the room, and he says, "Come down." He says, "I have a song I'd like you to listen to." So he had written on bits of scraps of paper the lyrics to Mama Courtney. Well, I nearly fell over when I heard it. Because it was like, you know, I gave him all of the words, but the way he put it together
just conjured up something.
Because everyone thinks I wrote that song, which I didn't, because it's so true to form. And when I was singing it, I remember the following year after I recorded it, myself and Jimmy Buckley and Patrick Feeney were on tour with the Three Amigos, and I had to sing it live. Now that was tough.
Okay.
You know, because it brought back all sorts of memories of Mama Courtney and Papa Courtney.
Big emotions, yeah.
She's passed away, he's passed away, and that was tough.
Yeah.
But to be able to have a song like that tells your whole life story in 3.5 minutes. I mean, fair play to Henry. I couldn't write that song the way he did it.
Magical.
Just couldn't do it.
Yeah. Well, over your career, you've recorded with a number of artists, including another American, Colin Ray. Had you met previously to that recording?
No, I didn't. I hadn't met him. As a matter of fact, at that time, there was a lot of different American artists were coming over to Ireland. Colin Ray had come over, and I'm trying to think now, Gene Watson, we were talking about earlier, he came over as well. And I've always admired Colin Ray's music. I think he's a fantastic singer and entertainer. And I had a contact who knew him. So I happened to be in Granard in the studio. And Colin Ray basically just one day as he was passing, heading back to America, he stopped into the studio, didn't know what I was going to sing. I had this song prepared. And Colin Ray came in. He said, "Hi, guys. What are y'all going to sing?" And I said, "Well, we're going to sing Murder on Music Row. Well, let's get to it." And he walked in, stood in front of the microphone, sang it one take, shook our hands and walked out.
Seamlessly.
But now, before we move off Colin Ray, I recall, I'm going to say 2002 to 4-ish. I was in Nashville, of course. I know you know because you were there as well.
We both were, yeah.
And there's a mall there, a big shopping center. And in the middle of the mall, there was a recording booth.
Yes.
And for all of you viewers and listeners out there, now I'm not laughing because it was bad.
I am.
me and Gabby went into the studio. Now, I can't remember whether we had hangovers from the night before or maybe we were drunk on the day.
Both.
But we went in and we recorded Love Me by Colin Ray. Yes. And someday, and as a matter of fact, even between the time this goes out on air, if I can find it, I want you to play a clip of it.
Well, we might, but all I can say is Colin Ray made a hit of it and we made something else that sounds like a hit of it.
Sounds just like his. Yeah.
Now, in 2010, you were inducted into Shreveport's Walk of the Stars alongside the greats like Elvis Presley and Hank Williams Sr. That surely had to be a very proud moment for you.
Yeah, it was. It was. And the reason why it was so special is because I was actually only talking to my wife about this recently. During the lockdown, I have missed Louisiana something fierce. Maybe it's because I have more time to think about it. Obviously, I'm thinking about my family. And even as we speak today, there has been awful storms down there. The hurricane has come down through Lake Charles. There was a time when I didn't want to go to Louisiana. I had a lot of bad memories there. I didn't want to be back in it. I didn't want to be a part of it. But due to the fact that a friend of mine who I made friends with over the last number of years, Kelly Wells, he's the sports commissioner in Shreveport, I brought a tour out there, and me and Kelly met, and Kelly was just amazed by my story. We're around the same age, and we sort of consider each other brothers now at this stage. And Kelly said to me, "Man, you know, you've done so much. Even back in Ireland, every album that I do, I record a song with the word Louisiana in it or the title. Mm-hmm. Something that I wanted to try to keep the Louisiana part of me alive." And Kelly recognized that. Now, nobody else really took much notice.
Okay.
But Kelly said that to me. And he said, "You know what?" He said, "I'd like to honor you." He says, "The mayor of Shreveport would like to honor you with the Walk of Stars." And I'm on the Walk of Stars. I mean, I haven't lived here in 25, 30 years. And Kelly said, "No." He says, "You haven't been here." He says, "But you've always kept Louisiana alive." And he said, "For that reason," he says, "we're going to honor you." So they had a ceremony and they sent over this this massive big award that was made out of some stone that was taken out of a quarry in Louisiana or something like that. And it's fabulous and it's in pride of place at home.
So those are fantastic trips because including Shreveport, New Orleans, Nashville, Memphis, Austin, San Antonio, you take in a whole array of places across the southern states.
Yeah, well, I think for so many years, Louisiana, the people of Louisiana wouldn't be used to coming to Ireland as much, I would say, as the people from other states, only because it's so far away. So I wanted to try and bring some people over here to show them what I've been doing and show them what I've loved about Irish people and loved about Ireland. And I can tell you, we've brought them over there to show them Louisiana and we bring them back here. And it cements what I was saying to you earlier on about the Irish people and the people of Louisiana could get on so very well.
Okay.
And I'm lucky that I'm one of them that has.
Yeah. And when you're not flying west to the States, you're also going south to Spain. You do a trip there as well.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, Spain is, suntan lotion, plenty of alcohol, sunshine.
Panadols.
It's Panadols, yeah, you get a bit of that as well. But we were, as a matter of, just before the lockdown came, we just planned a trip going out in May, which we had to cancel. I've been building this up over the last number of years. It's called Boogie on the Brava. And there's bigger trips that go out, but we had we had something beautiful built up.
And it's not always better.
Not all the time. Not all the time. And we had a great group of people who got to know each other and kept coming back year after year. And then all of a sudden, the floodgates came in and with the virus and all that. But look, we will get back to it. And I want to thank, in particular, we had to reschedule this year's trip to next year. And I want to thank all those people out there who've stayed with me and who've kept supporting that trip. Because, you know, when this thing is all over, and which it will be over.
Yeah.
And when that happens, people are going to be itching to get back on the swimming togs. And I'll be there to bring you.
And the locals all love to see you coming as well. Yeah.
And you'll always spot the Irish people coming over because we're the ones with the red shoulders, you know, and everything else is white.
Well, you mentioned the unfortunate lockdown. Yeah. And prior to that, you were working on a project, the Nashville Songbook.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about that and what people might expect when it eventually gets on the road?
Yeah, I suppose one of my biggest regrets because of the lockdown. I mean, I've been working on the Spanish trip. I've been working on other projects. But the Nashville Songbook was something that I was really looking forward to because it's a celebration of country music as it is. And what I mean by that is I mean that every song that we picked was picked because it was an iconic song of a particular time. Mm-hmm. And we were going to basically walk people through the history of country music in a couple of hours.
Yeah.
Noreen Rabbit was coming on with me. And we, as a matter of fact, the stage that we're sitting on now, we were here only a few months ago putting this all together. We had all this different work done, and then all of a sudden the curtain came down and we had to get rid of it. But look, Matt Levy was also going to be an intricate part of that show. He was here with us. But I said it to you before we went on air that if it's the last thing that I do, we are going to get the Nashville Songbook on stage. And I think it's going to be better than ever now because I think people are going to have an extra hunger for good country music. And I'm not saying it's good because I'm singing it, but it'll be good because the show we're going to put on for you is like something you've never seen before.
And you have a bit more time to reflect on it and
plenty of time. Tidy
it up a little
and
bit.
And if it's not absolutely perfect on the first night, it's because we're lazy. We have all the time in the world.
I don't think we can say that about you, Rob.
Yeah.
Well, it's been an absolute pleasure having you along. And just before I let you go, I'd say you've lived in Ireland 20 years and you've built up an amazing life and a fantastic career and you're blessed with a wonderful family.
Yeah.
But if you could send a message back to the young Rob from today, what would you say to yourself?
Don't eat that pepper, it's too hot. No, I think to be honest, I would say if you have a notion, if you have a thought, you have a dream, go with it.
Go for it.
Because if I hadn't have done that sometime and just said, you know what, whatever I'm going to do happens. When I came to Ireland, I stepped off a plane and I hadn't a clue where I was going. I really didn't know where I was going, hadn't a clue, but look what happened. And I'm thankful for that.
And finally, I'm going to put you on the spot here. And you've recorded 12 albums to date, as I mentioned earlier on. If I were to ask you to pick one track that sums up Robert Mizzell and says who he is and what he does best, which one would you go for?
Kick-Ass Country.
That's Robert.
And the reason why I'm going to say that is because the song was written for me, Tommy Swarbrick. It was the very first song that was ever released in Ireland, my first recording. And it tells the story, and he wrote the song for me, and it tells the story of me going through Louisiana with my mother and father singing country music. And I love rock and roll, which I do. I love pop, I love jazz, but you can't beat kick-ass.
It's still a good radio hit when it comes on.
There you go.
Well, Robert, I'd like to thank you for being my guest today. Thanks for joining us. It's been an honor and a pleasure.
Thank you.
My thanks to Robert Mizzell, and we can't let him go without performing another song. So we go back to the main stage where Rob is joined by Wayne Thoreau's on piano and the lovely Noreen Rabbit. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Mizzell, we'll see you next week.
In a pawn shop in Chicago, on a sunny summer day, a couple gazes at the wedding rings there on display.
Well, she smiles and nods her head as she says, honey, that's for you. It's not much, but it's the best that I can do.
Golden ring with one tiny little stone waiting there for someone to take it home by itself. It's just a cold metallic thing. Only love can make a golden wedding ring. In a little wedding chapel later on that afternoon, an old upright piano plays that old familiar tune.
As tears roll down her cheeks and happy thoughts run through her head, as he whispers low, with this ring I thee wed.
Golden ring, with one tiny little stone, shining ring, now at last it's found a home by itself. It's just a call, but tell it thing, only love can make a golden wedding. In a small two-room apartment, as they fought their final round, says you won't admit it, but I know you're leaving town.
Well, she says one thing's for certain, I don't love you anymore, and throws down my ring as she walks out the door.
Golden ring, with one time cast aside, like the love that's dead and gone by itself. It's just a cold metallic thing, only love can make a golden wedding ring. In a pawn shop in Chicago, on a sunny summer day,
a couple gazes at their wedding